This episode is brought to you by Ardan Labs Education. Sign up today to learn advanced concepts in Go, Docker, Kubernetes, Terraform, and more. Visit ardenlabs.com/education for more information.
Hi, welcome to the Ardan Labs podcast. My name is Bill Kennedy, and our special guest today is Florent Biville. Hey, Florent, thank you for joining us today.
Thanks for having me. Good to be here.
Where are you coming from today?
And so I'm from France, and I live a bit outside Paris.
Nice. Oh, my God. I think the last time I went to Paris was... You had like this massive snowstorm of like the century. The whole city shut down. People were leaving their motorbikes in like town because they couldn't drive them out. And I hate snow. So it was just one of those things where like I brought unlucky snow to the city.
Oh yeah, it happens every few years and yeah, it gets quite messy.
Yeah, that's wild. All right, give everybody like the 2 minute drill, I call it, on kind of what you're doing today. What is Florent doing today?
Sure. So I work at Neo4j. So Neo4j is a graph database company. So the main product is Neo4j, and I maintain the official code driver for it. So that's mostly what I do. And I also maintain, you know, relationships with the driver community. So people outside Neo4j who also maintain, you know, drivers or projects built out of our drivers. That's mainly my two roles. So the biggest one being the code driver maintenance, really.
Yeah, that's a big responsibility because, for any language, right? Not just Go, let's say, but for any language, because if that driver's not working, nobody can really use the database, right? I mean, that's the edge of the database at the end of the day. So. Did you, I want to get to all this, but I'm just curious right now, is that the Go driver that you developed for Neo, were you able to build that from the ground up? Were you part of the team that wrote that initially, or are you coming in and maintaining it? I'm more curious on the idioms and your ability to make that look and feel like Go.
So it's a project that actually has a fun history. Like it's been created twice, but I came a bit after the second creation, so to say. So no, I'm only here to maintain it. I've seen the code since, of course, but I've not worked directly with creating it the second time, and even less so for the first time. It was wrong. Yeah.
Gotcha. Last year, I decided I wanted to learn graph databases, and a buddy of mine started the company called dgraph. So I was learning a lot about graph databases leveraging dgraph. I think they're amazing databases. I think they can even be used as general purpose databases. I think there's this beautiful mix of, like, for me, like SQL integrity with NoSQL kind of flexibility. I mean, what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, and that's really what drew it to me like a few years ago as well, is just the flexibility of the model and indeed, you know, the dynamic nature of it, like how fast you can iterate on a model, change it, you know, revise it, etc., without being tied initially with a rigid schema. And so that plus the fun query language, those were really the two things that drew me to the graph database landscape, really.
All right, we're going to get back to all of this because I've got a lot of questions. But this podcast isn't really about graph databases. It's about you. So I'm going to ask you first of all, did you grow up in Paris? You grew up in France?
So I grew up in France, but I lived in Normandy. So northwestern part of France, not in Paris.
Okay. And then, again, the schooling system is so different, not so different, but different enough than in the States. So just to get a general sense of time frames here, when did you finish, what year were you when you kind of finished grade school and could think about university? Like in the US, that's usually like when you're 17 or 18.
Sorry. Yeah, the age is similar here. So we finish high school usually at 18 years old, and then we start university or other path at that age, really. So in my case, it was around 2004.
2004.
I started, yeah.
Okay. Don't say any more to me. 2004. Okay, that gives me a good kind of general sense of where tech is, and I think it helps everyone. It helps me. All right. Here's my favorite question. Here we go. All right. I just don't think too hard on this. What is your first memory of working on a computer? That first memory that pops in your head.
So I'm afraid I've thought too hard already because I researched it a little bit. My memories were a bit too vague. And so I asked around. I cheated. I'm sorry. Basically, I
wait,
think
wait, wait,
it
wait,
was
wait,
around...
wait, time out. I'm going to interrupt you throughout this process here. Who did you ask? You asked your family.
My mom.
Your mom. Yeah, you asked your mom. Yeah. Her first remembrance of you working on a computer. So this is more mom.
So I wouldn't call it working, yeah, but she was the one, you know, being in charge and using the computers. My father was allergic to computers until maybe
allergic
2 years ago. Yes, I would describe it like that. He didn't want to know about it. Didn't want to hear about it. He was really reluctant to use any of these things. So my mother was doing, you know, accountancy, etc. And the first computer she brought home, I believe, was a Tandy computer around 94, 95. She bought it from the union she was involved with. And I remember her, I think it was Windows 3.1 or something. You know, you had this file tree interface, you would browse your files like that, start programs. And that's the vague memories I have of it. I was mostly watching, really. I didn't actively use it. Or I would ask my mother, hey, can you start this this game? But that's about it, really. My first experience was mostly watching.
Yeah, well, I mean, you're like 7 or 8 years old at that point, too. But was your mom... Okay, this is the question. Was your mom protective of the computer because she didn't want you to break it? Or were you kind of scared to maybe jump on it yourself because you didn't want to break it? What's the kind of... You remember any of that?
For some reason, I don't think I even thought of accessing the computer by myself. So I don't think I even tried. I think that possibility completely eluded me at the time. It was like spending time with my mother, watching what she was doing, sometimes asking for some game time, but I would need her help. Yeah, I never thought about doing it myself, actually. So I couldn't even say if it's fear or maybe just, I don't know, lack of curiosity, maybe.
Or maybe you just saw it as your mom's a tool and not necessarily a plaything. So it didn't register. And your mom, you said your mom was an accountant.
So she's not an accountant, but she was doing, you know, this, you know, just checking the accounts for the family, etc. So she's a nurse. She was a nurse, retired now, but she was doing this. That's why she brought it home, basically, to automate a little bit accounting and this kind of chores.
So she's the technical one in the family then?
Yeah. She used to be, now I am, and now she has questions to me, but she used to be the one more tech inclined, really.
Now I got to ask, because you brought your dad up, what did your dad do, at least at the time, that he wasn't interested at all?
So at the time, he was a nurse manager, really. So they both worked in the same company, in the same, yeah, it's called Foundation in French, even though it's not exactly Foundation like in the US, but... So he was mostly managing teams of nurses and working with patients as well from time to time.
I mean, in 94, there were definitely computers being used in environments and offices at the time. Were they not using, or I mean, you may not be able to answer this, but you don't think they were using computers? Or maybe your dad was and he just hated it and he didn't want to do it at home.
I think I'm not sure they use computers at work. I know they were using it in the union because they had to manage, you know, membership fees, etc. So they were using some software for that. Because I remember going to the room and there were computers, so some computers there. But that's how we got the computer, actually. But I never really visited the workplace, you know, because it was some a sensitive area, I guess, given the kind of patients they were dealing with. So yeah, so I don't know, but given my father's reluctance to use any computers, I don't think he used any at work, or at least very minimally.
That's wild. So then, as you get into high school, right, those last 4 years of grade school, high school, is there? Well, I love this question too because, you know, high school and people have heard me say it. That's a really, 4 years, a very formative kind of time in your life, right? You're 14, 15 through 17, 18. You're trying to figure out what you want to do. You're getting at the end where you can start making decisions. So it's always interesting to me as you're entering into like that ninth grade, what are your interests at the time, or what do you think your interests are? Are you sports, music? Is it something technical? Like, what's going on?
So at that time, I was still pretty interested in soccer. So I was playing in a club. So I was still quite active doing that. I had taken again some guitar lessons as well. So I studied a little when I was a kid. So I was quite interested. But then, you know, I was not, organized enough. And I was not really a good student when I was a kid. So I dropped out after 3 years. And then they took back again because at the high school I was, there were tutors that would come, you know, every week just for free. You just had to register and we're like...
Wait. You dropped out of grade school?
No, sorry. I mean, dropped out probably in the wrong way. But when I was a kid, when I was taking guitar lessons.
Oh, the guitar, guitar. Sorry.
Yeah, guitar lessons. When I was a kid. No, I didn't drop out. I stopped the guitar lessons. My bad. That's what I meant, because I was not doing really my homework. The professor was getting pissed more and more every time I would come back and not, you know, see that I didn't practice enough. So yeah, so that kind of stopped me. I already have my regular homework, so I don't want to deal with this. And so that's why I waited many years before picking the guitar again in high school, when there were free courses there, basically.
It's like you wanted to learn how to play guitar, but you didn't want to put the work in.
Yeah, something like that. Something like that.
And you were more interested in playing soccer, it sounds like, than yeah, I mean, that makes sense. You were playing club level soccer, so I mean, you were pretty decent then, right?
I mean, yes and no. I had some I remember playing at some good level, like the maximum level, when I was 15 years old. So it was a national level, so quite a big deal. But I was not great in the team, really. I was probably one of the worst. And it was quite, you know, we were playing against the young teams of professional clubs sometimes, and we would lose like very, very bad. Like you would see the difference. Like we would lose, like, you know, like by a huge difference sometimes, like 10-0 or something, which is huge in soccer. That was tough. Yeah, so we were struggling in that division, and I was struggling within the team. So I was not that great, but still good memories of it, though.
So then as you're going through high school, what is starting to kind of pique your interest as you're walking through high school?
So when I was I was, you know, hesitant between becoming a journalist on following maybe a more, following a scientific curriculum. And then when I went to high school, yeah, basically forgot the idea about becoming a journalist and really went into science, so math, physics, etc. And I knew I wanted to do something like that. And it's only got a little bit concrete for the last year in high school when we had this parallel to university, we would have what we called schools of engineering, which lead to a master's degree. It's not exactly the same, organized the same way as universities, but anyway, I knew I wanted to do something like that, you know, getting in maybe into mathematics or computer science, but really more to, yeah, towards the end of high school, really. At the beginning, I was more into the general science curriculum without any precise idea.
But was it, I mean, I guess at that point, 2004, you said you graduated. So you must have had a pretty decent computer lab and kind of course curriculums in high school at that point.
So we didn't have back then like very strong, like I didn't have any programming courses in high school. So that didn't really happen. We had some basics. So before that, a few years before, you know, on how to use a word processor and these kind of things, we had some electronics course, but we didn't have any. I had, through a project, we had some basic, we had to use some basic a little bit, but that was really because that particular project required it, but that was really a very short introduction. We didn't have any formal training until I landed into my school of engineering, really. That's when it really started on the computer science side of things. And I was saying, for some reason, even though I had not had a formal introduction to computer science, I was quite drawn to it, even though I was not really knowing. So I saw some demonstrations of when I visited the schools, and I saw some demonstrations of what they were doing with computers, and it looked like I was like, hey, it looked very cool. I want to do something like this, even though I didn't have any concrete ideas of what they were doing.
Okay, that was going to be my question. It's, where is the interest coming from if you're not seeing it in high school? You're not necessarily doing it at home. You're not thinking about any of that. So it's when you started touring the different engineering schools and you started seeing the potential of that curriculum, you were like, okay, this is cool.
Yeah, that I think that really helped me in making my final decision. And the rest was maybe a buildup of years of fiddling with stupid things on the computer, you know, customizing sounds or what have you, when you have different events, etc. But the real interest, like the real concrete interest, really started to form when I visited those schools, and so concrete demonstration of the kind of things they could do, like image processing or, you know, simulations, etc. That really piqued my interest more concretely.
So as you're finishing high school and now you're trying to figure out what, it sounds like in your head you're going to university one way. Like, it wasn't job market, it wasn't trade, it was, I'm going to go to university and study engineering. How many schools did you apply to, or you just knew already in your head this was the school I was going to?
I already kind of knew. So it was basically a network of schools. So I have had a choice between 5 different cities. But because I was interested in computer science, I had like 3 out of those 5. And so you have some kind of admission steps to go through. And I got the one I wanted to very early. So I decided, you know what, that's what I want. That's where I want to go. So I looked around a little more, like, but I was already kind of set on this one. So I didn't search for too long, really.
How far away was the university from home? Did that play a factor at all, just to get out of the house? And were you like 3 hours away? Were you like, how far away was it?
Yeah, I think it was most 4 hours ish away. But I didn't think about it until I moved there. Then I realized, oh, I'm actually a bit far away from home and far away from my friends, because most of my friends went to a closer city when there is a university there. So that's when I realized the disconnect, and like, oh, I had to start my network of friends all over again. So that's a pattern in my life, you know, thinking about what I want to do and then realizing the consequences after the decision. So that was one big example of that.
I guess you had it in your head that you would just come home every weekend and you were going to maintain your network of friends. When I went, I wanted to get out of my house so bad, but I couldn't afford to go to university outside of the state I lived in, because tuition's always a lot more expensive. So I found the school that was like the farthest away. It was like, I don't know, about 8 or 9 hours away while still being in the state. But I knew very well I wasn't going back home. Like, I was going to start over with all new. I kind of been like that my whole life. I just move, and I'm just going to start over. So do you still have any of those friends, though, from high school in your life today?
Not really. I think basically that whole network of friends vanished after the first years of being, you know, in that other city, really. So it's been hard to track them again. So that's one of the small regrets I have, basically doing that choice, but it paid off in other ways.
I have one person in my life that I met in kindergarten. We don't really live close, but we keep in touch. I have one person from university that I still talk to. Like, that's kind of my life. Like, I, you know, have that one person, but I try to tell my kids that, like, the relationships you have today, they're great, they're powerful, but like 4 years from now, it's going to be all new people, right? And it's really hard to understand that when you're young.
And I actually visited my School of Engineering the other day and talked to first year students. And that's exactly what we told them. You know, after graduation, all the connections you have right now, you're probably going to lose a big chunk of it. So if you want to stay in contact, try to start now. Try to foster those relationships now. And because we take it for granted while we are around, you know, we are surrounded by friends, etc. But then when we move on, it's so much harder to maintain relationships like that.
Yeah. All right, so this engineering school that you go into in 2004, is this like a four-year program for the engineering?
So it's a five-year program. So it's split in 2 years of, you know, general common courses for everyone, and then you specialize, and it depends on what the school offers, basically. So, but computer science starts right away in those common common 2 years, and then you can specialize. You know, you had so in the school I was, there was like chemistry, mechanics, energetics, computer science, mathematics, or environment engineering as well. And those were the...
So I'm sure as a freshman you had it in your head what you were going to specialize in. So did you end up specializing in what you thought you were going to be specializing in when you started? And what did you end up specializing in?
Yeah, so I was basically hesitating between two choices. One was mathematics. We had quite a lot of computer science, but obviously more applied mathematics than the other department, so what we call department. And the other department was mostly computer science, a bit of electronics, a bit of signal processing, but you know, much more computer sciencey than the other one. And the more it went, the more abstract the mathematics courses I attended were, I realized, okay, I guess that's getting too complex for me. Or maybe the interaction with the teacher, you know, sometimes you have those very strict teachers, like if you ask wrong, they will get angry. If you answer wrong, they will get angry as well. And you just get paralyzed, you know, these kind of situations. So if you combine that with, you know, a bit more advanced mathematics at the time for me, I was like, okay, I guess that's, it's just a signal to me that it's not for me, and that's why I chose the computer science department. So it's not called like that. I think it was like information system and architecture. What's the official name of the department? But that's the one I picked after the. I was pretty sure after 1 year into the beginning really that I wanted to go there.
Were you even thinking? I have a sense that you weren't even thinking like career after university. You were just kind of focused on what you wanted to learn. You were going to worry about career, because if the math ended up resonating with you more, even at an abstract level, like what are your choices in industry when you get to that level of kind of abstract math? You're going to be in the basement somewhere in CERN? Like, were you thinking at all what you wanted to do?
A bit, but it was still quite abstract. We would hear, you know, from time to time in school, like they would tell us about general trends, you know, like for instance, if you apply to chemistry, you would struggle a lot finding a job because those kind of jobs were harder and harder to find. So we would have some kind of connection to the job market. But to me, at least, it was quite abstract. I was, you know, just fresh from high school and I had some notion. So engineering was, you know, being an engineer in France, is already a good step into securing a good position, like a good financial position and a good job. But then that's basically where my reasoning stopped. I was like, okay, I had some idea on what kind of specialty lead to what kind of career, but not a very concrete option.
Was there a lot of, in those last 2 years, right, of your engineering degree, since you go into the informatics, right, that's what you're, was there, what was the main focus? Was there a lot of software, was there a lot of programming? Was there more database? Was there more kind of systems? What were they really kind of pushing at the time?
So I think the main focus was still programming. So that was the main focus, really. Like we started with C. We also did some, what's the name? Ada, do I pronounce that right?
Oh, really?
Ada programming language.
Wow.
Yes, we did one semester, one project on that. I mean, you had the choice between C and that. And for some reason, we picked the group, the team, the project team, or picked that one. I forgot.
You thought it was going to be easier. You're like, no, this is going to be easier. I promise.
Yep. And I forgot all about it. You know, I just remember, oh, they did the automated metro with that. That's great. But I don't remember the language at all. So, yeah, that's... but, yeah, you really, like, C... I mean, yeah, there were programming all along, like C, Ada, then Java, a lot more into the fourth year, so the second year of the second cycle. And then, of course, you had also...
Was the programming resonating with you? Because I meet people who just like, they love it, the light bulb goes on, this is what I want to do. And then sometimes you meet people that are just like, no, this is not what I want to be doing.
Oh, yeah. And I mean, that really resonated with me. You know, I still remember the first time I run a simple program that would display, you know, the hour and, you know, the seconds would change. So it was in C. And I'm like, wow, I just produced something I can see, like getting super concrete. And I still remember that. Even more though than, you know, the first fake programs. I mean, it's all were real programs that I would do with my calculator, which would not do much. But those one after, you know, starting the School of Engineering, writing my first programs in C and seeing something, that was like, wow, I can actually do that. And I can actually, you know, have this feedback and I can create something really. That really resonated a lot with me. And that's what stuck with me for, I mean, still to these days, that's also, yeah. One of the things I enjoy.
So what was your, I love this question too. What was your favorite kind of class? Can you remember your favorite class or maybe like your worst class? Like, don't ever want to take that again.
Yeah, I had both a best and worst class, I think. So let's start maybe with the best. So the best one, it was like the first year of the second cycle. So, you know, you're, you know, getting into that specialization. Sorry. and so we dived right into, you know, computer architecture, basics, etc. Oh, that's the stuff I wanted to see, right? I was waiting 2 years with general purpose programming and chemistry, etc. You know, that's what I want to hear about. It was great because, you know, you had all the basics about computer architecture, knowing how it works, how each component relates to each other. And I was like, oh, man, that's what I wanted to see. And was so happy with that course, I remember. And the worst one was... I don't even know. I guess course were just called sensors. And we would read, so some exercises were just, we would read sensor specs and answer some questions related to these specs. And we were, most of the class were like, we don't want to do that. We just want to write some code, right? We don't want to read sensor specs and just answer questions based on that. Like, why are we even doing this? And so this one was one of the worst, really, because it felt so distant from the rest of what we were doing, really.
Yeah, you couldn't get your hands. It would have been different, I guess, if they gave you sensors that you could program, and it doesn't sound like they were doing that. No.
Not really.
So, you know, it's now like 2009. You're about to graduate. You've done your 5 years at university. What are you thinking next? Are you thinking more education, or you're finally ready to get into a job market? Like 2009 was a little of a tough year, right? At least in the US, we had a small financial collapse with housing and mortgages. I don't know if that was affecting France at the time.
So I only have vague, I mean, I remember reading the news about this. I think it affected France, but I cannot really remember in how many details. There wasn't, yeah, definitely consequences, but maybe not as hard as in the US. But again, I'm not completely sure. And so at the time in 2009, I actually did my last year abroad, so in Germany, because I wanted also to practice my German. And I had two choices, basically stay in Berlin when I completed my studies and did an internship, or go back to Paris. And I picked the easy solution, which was go back to Paris, because in Germany, there is no concept of school of engineering. They know university, but they don't know school of engineering. And so they know even less the reputation of my school because they don't have those. So no, I had to kind of sell that on CV when you're just fresh out of school. I don't have any experience to maybe show as an asset. So I was thinking along the lines, you know what, going back to Paris, at least the school is well-known in France, it's going to work out better. I already had some job opportunities there, thanks to the network of alumni and other people in my class. So that's why I come back, basically, because it was much easier to find a job, and I had a couple of opportunities at the time.
Okay, I got to ask you this, because I love Berlin. I'd love to like buy a place in Berlin. That's how much I love Berlin. And I rarely meet anyone who didn't like visit Berlin on a vacation and never leave, right? Like, the city's amazing. So you end up in Berlin to do your last year interning. I want to know kind of what that internship was about. But you're one of the very few people I've ever met that said, no, no, I'm going to leave Berlin after even being there for a year. Did you, I mean, I'm actually curious, like, did you not love Berlin or were, did
no,
you not think
I
you
loved
can
it.
Be? Okay.
Yeah, I loved Berlin and I would have loved to stay, but on the other hand, I was not sure. I think at some point I felt, so my internship was in a company which is still around, which is called Game Duel, so an online game company, like casual games. And I was working, I don't even remember exactly what we were doing. that's very bad, but what I was doing was not especially great. You know, it was mostly adding marketing pixel tags to some giant Java pages, you know, just add this if else block in there, you know, among the thousand other ones. This kind of work, so not necessarily super interesting. And so I didn't have any prospect in that company. And I was, and again, I loved the company and I would have loved to stay there, but I picked the safest option for me, which at the time, which was to go back to France. But yeah, I won't say I regretted that choice, but I would definitely love to come back to Berlin if I can, because yeah, as you said, the city is just great for everyone. There is room for everyone, whatever their hobbies are, etc., etc. It's a great city, and I regret not being able to, you know, to maybe stay a bit longer or find a job opportunity there.
But now it's interesting because if you're going back to France, you need a place to at least live. So did you go back to your parents' house at that point until you figured out what you were going to do next? Or did you already line up a job before you left?
So I lined up a couple of job interviews, which were not really intense. So basically I got two firm options. So I picked one and then basically everything started from there. I just visited a few flats and I was lucky because it was, in the quiet season really for flat hunting. So I didn't have any trouble. I was quite lucky really. The time I came back was a perfect time to find accommodation. So I didn't struggle at all. Didn't have to stay at my parents' place really. Everything went very smoothly, luckily for me.
You were, okay. So what company did you end up at and what were you doing? And I guess it gave you enough salary to be able to live alone. You didn't have to have roommates. Wow, that's pretty wild.
So in Berlin, I was with roommates because I had, you know, just this small internship income. But Berlin was super cheap as well, so that was enough. In Paris, yeah, I had a good enough salary to get a flat by myself. And so the company, I don't think it's around anymore. It was basically a Steam competitor. So again, you know, with game, you could either download games and play or play online. That was mostly the business model of it. It basically died down, like Steam won by a large extent. And I was doing so, I was working on the front end part of those applications. And we were doing several, I don't remember the exact term in English, but when you would have a website declined in different versions, depending on the customer, like we would work for some company and we would just style those pages.
Oh, you're white labeling.
White labeling, thank you, I forgot.
Okay.
Yes.
That's right.
So that's what I was doing at the time, mostly, you know, PHP and front-end work.
Did you know PHP before you went to that company? Because it's the first time you're dropping PHP. Everything you've done so far is like, I guess Java, I guess HTML, CSS, right? JavaScript in the internship. So this is a PHP job.
So this is, yeah, my first job was a PHP job. And actually, I forgot to mention, we learned a bit of PHP at school in the web courses, you know, web programming course. We saw different ones. And that's a language that stuck with me for some reason. You know, maybe because of the same thing that I described with my first program. Like, you write something, you see it. Like, that was, you know, short feedback loop and great experience for me. And many my age in France, when they started programming a bit more seriously, they would do PHP. Like that was a language, the go-to language for many of my generation, I think. I believe that's because of the, you know, easy feedback loop. There is no compilation phase, etc. So that was really great to tinker with. And that's why I could have picked Java, but for some reason at the time, I changed my mind since, but it felt like a bit more, you know, heavyweight, hard, complex, etc. You know, I want to do PHP. It's easier and I enjoy it more. And that's how I am.
So you had the experience, like, that internship helps a lot. Like, we don't have that in the U.S. I hear about that a lot in Europe, where you get that 1 year of internship, and now you have something on your CV that says, you know, I've worked at a company. Even if you don't want to treat it as your first job, it was your first job, and you get that experience, I mean, out of the way. So that must have helped even for you to get this first job, say, back in France.
Yeah, that helped definitely a little bit. The fact that we have two internships. So one is a bit shorter, like 3 months. So it's, of course, on a reduced topic. And the last one, so actually I had 6 months of studies and 6 months of internship. So 6 months, that's a full one. So yeah, that helps, of course. And also we also have projects in school with the companies. So that's specific to the school I was, where we would have also part-time projects for 2 semesters. So also concrete, you know, concrete problems to solve for the industry, really. So those things help a little bit, you know, to compensate for the lack of experience we would have going out from school, definitely.
But this is wild, right? You're 22 years old, it's 2009, you got your first job, like real professional job you truly interviewed for, and you got it, and you're in Paris, and you're living the life, dude. 22, in Paris, on your own. Good job. Like, what is your role in this company, and how long are you at this company?
So I stayed a bit fewer than 2 years, I think. And my role was, so they were contracting for the whole front end thing, and they wanted to, you know, come back in house. So my role was basically to cover the transition period. So work with the contractor, you know, get to know the code base, and then basically work on my own. And then they actually hired a couple more people after that. So I was the lead, even though I was, you know, leading myself, I guess. But it's good for the ego, right? Yeah, I'm the lead developer of the one-person team. So that's what I did.
All coding in, like, PHP for this. This was a gaming platform, too.
Yes. So, yeah, all the front-end was PHP and some, you know, templating and HTML, CSS, and a bit of JavaScript, yeah.
So then what happens in 2011? Are you, something comes across your desk, some recruiter hits you up, you're bored, like what's happening in 2011?
So even a bit before that, I got more and more interested. So I started hanging out with so the lead developer of the company, which was mostly focused on the back end. So it was, you know, lots of Java, Spring framework, etc. And he got me super interested in that. But sadly, because of my responsibilities, I could not switch to full-time backend and learn Java, etc. But I would hang out with him. I would attend the local Java user group and learn about, you know, those rock star speakers from other countries, and start to see the ecosystem, the community. And I'm like, damn, that's actually super interesting. I would love to be able to be full-time, you know, work full-time with Java and learn more about the ecosystem. And because of the impossibility really to switch to full-time, I started to look around, you know, so also the Java user groups were great for that, because I could chat with people from that community and see what was there. And that's how it led me to my next gig, really.
Oh, okay. So you really wanted to work in Java in Spring, all that stuff you were seeing, these kind of cool people working on, and you weren't going to have that opportunity where you were. So, and then I guess you had everybody was telling you at that point who they're hiring or what they're looking for in terms of hiring. So what's the next company that gives you an opportunity, I'm imagining, in Java, which you had some experience from university?
Yes. And I also even studied while I was, you know, mainly working on PHP, the Java certification. So that was how involved I was, and my lead developer helped me a lot with that. And so what happened? So I met a couple of people from these Java user groups, and they were creating a small consultancy company, like completely managed by developers, like company of three people, and they were looking for their first hire. And that's basically, I was interested by that. And I said, well, you know what, I'm in. So the company was called Lateral Thoughts. It was very small contracting shop that were doing mostly based on their network of customers. We would do gigs like that. So mostly around Java, etc. And I got super interested and said, you know what, I'm in. I just want to try. And I was their first hire. And I think the company was not even finalized when I did the interview. They finalized it maybe 1 month later.
I'm actually curious. Were you able to at least maintain your salary? Did you have to take a pay cut? This is kind of a scary situation. Like, this was not going to necessarily be stable. So just kind of curious where your head was related to salary and security.
I think, if I remember correctly, actually I had a pay raise. So when we discussed about salary, when they agreed after I'd done the final interview, maybe not that much, but little more that I had in the previous company. And they also, you know, they were just in the phase of creating the company. So they had calculated everything, like how much finance do we need to have in reserve, you know, they really made sure they had enough capital to be able to sustain a new hire in case there is, you know, no contract going. So we don't even negotiate at that point. So I just got a little bit more of what I had before. So I was, I guess, quite lucky as well. I sometimes don't realize my luck, but yeah.
But they must have raised some money then. Did they have an office? Was everybody working remote? Because either that or they packed away a lot of cash over the years to start this.
I think they didn't have that much capital, but they were all freelancers. They were already working with customers. They had good relationships with them. So they had enough capital, I guess, to sustain maybe 3 or 4 months of me being unemployed, which didn't happen, but they had some advance. And and they had good relationships with the customers, so they knew they could staff more people there, really.
I see. Yeah, that's cool. So how long? So at this point now, you're doing Java, you're doing consulting, which is, I think, a great skill for everybody to have, because you walk in, I call it chaos engineering, to be honest with you. You don't know what you're walking into half the time, and your job is to try to stabilize while continue to move things forward. So did you enjoy a little bit of that kind of chaos? It's hard. It's not intuitive how to operate in that environment initially. So did you enjoy that? Did you kind of flourish in that? Did you not enjoy it?
So I think I completely blew it, because I didn't know the codes of consulting really and how to communicate, because I was first in-house. You know, we were just always the same people, always working on the same thing and quite transparent about who would work. So the first gig, I actually almost got fired because I was a bit too explicit. Like, for instance, at every stand-up, and it was their first agile project in the company, so there was quite a lot of scrutiny. And I would say, oh, I have this and this and that problem. Like, could someone help me? You know, but I was maybe a bit too explicit about it. And so at some point, someone came to me and said, hey, it seems you only ever have problems. Like, what's going on? While others, you know, would phrase them a bit more or less, in a less obvious way, et cetera, et cetera. So that's the kind of things that got me in trouble in my first gig. But actually, that was a good, hard-earned lesson. And when I got an opportunity to actually step out of that project, I said, you know what, maybe it's better for me to actually move to somewhere else, because, I don't know, it was kind of tough, really, to have the discussion with the manager and say, you know what, we're maybe letting you go. And that was quite a big shock for me back then. So I almost blew it. But then I moved on to another customer, completely different, which they worked with for years and much, much more, you know, I was about to say easygoing. That's probably not the right term, but a much more relaxed setting with a great team, you know, great productive team. People were getting along super well. So that was really like from one end of the spectrum to the other, really. That was really what I needed at the time. And I didn't even experience an employment between the two gigs. It really just started after, right after. So that was really, really great for me in that case. And that's why I also continued consulting after that.
Yeah, no, I tell a lot of people that come to Ardan all the time, I'm like, your first 2 or 3 months, don't complain about anything, just solve problems. Even if it's not the prettiest way to solve it, solve problems. And once the client is seeing that you're solving problems, you can start to talk about how to change things for the better. But if you do that day one, right, like it's not good. It just doesn't come across proper. But that's stuff you have to learn. You learn that pretty quickly. So I'm glad you stuck with that. Now, how long are you with this company in this kind of consulting role?
So around 4 years. I stayed 4 years with them mostly. So yeah, that was good actually, seeing different customers, the different organizations, different problems, organizational problems as well. That was quite interesting because, you know, we were a bit from the outside, so we can observe without suffering too much of the consequences. So that was a privileged position really to watch those problems and try to address them in a way. Even though I was still very junior at the time, so I didn't have much leverage at this level, but yeah, lots of experience gained there. And in terms, you know, of, I was probably very naive when I started, but you know, in terms of proper behavior, in terms of technical experience as well, and organizations, really, that was very formative for me.
But I say it all the time, ignorance is bliss. Sometimes it's good to be ignorant because you won't do things otherwise, that even if there's some hardship and a little bit of failure, that's where you're learning, right? So being naive is almost an asset to yourself at times, right?
Yep.
But that's the other kind of cool thing about, again, chaos engineering, is that at least, you know, almost every year, like, you could almost be on a different project solving different problems, and you don't get bored necessarily. I think you get more burnt out than maybe bored. So were you kind of starting to get burnt out after those 4 years?
Yeah, I think I wanted to work again for a software publisher, you know, not switching customers every 6 months, you know, rediscovering an organization, going elsewhere in Paris because the commute is not always easy. So I really wanted to find, you know, a more stable environment, so to say. So that's, and I think, yeah, I mostly stopped my consulting after that. Then I started working for companies directly, not as a contractor. So that's what really was something. I needed more stability, really. I was glad for the experience I gained, but not so glad for all the different commutes and different logistical problem.
I imagine as well you were continuing to go to the meetup groups for Java and was there any other new tech in those 4 years that started to get your interest? Is that when kind of graph databases start to get a little bit on your radar screen?
Yeah, actually, the first time I heard about it was in my first job. I didn't do anything with it, but that's when I heard first about Neo4j, because we were thinking about, back-end engineers were thinking about ways to prevent fraud and, you know, and burning game activation keys, because once a game activation key is blacklisted, it's lost forever. So you lose part of your stock like that. So there was actually real financial implications of trying to make the anti-fraud detection efficient. So that's the first time I heard about it. But then it's only a couple of years later then I stumbled upon Neo4j again. And really out of curiosity, that's really how it started. It looked fun. That was my approach then. It looked fun. So I got interested and started some, you know, small disposable side projects on it for me. And that's really, that's the period when it started, when I was at the lateral soaps for those 4 years. Yeah, so I didn't jump into, you know, unknown territory. I went to a customer that we worked previously. So it's called, so in France, it's quite known actually, because the company is a bit more than 100 years old. It's called Vidal. And historically, they produce a dictionary of drugs. You know, you have the drugs, you have the definition. That's what they used to do. So there's a kind of the authority on drug data. And what I did is join as a lead developer. So that was really my first lead role. A bit too early, actually, but that's also something I learned, because, you know, management, like, oh, you have to deal with, you know, usually it's not the same as just, you know, programming. So that's the kind of things I learned, of course, on the job. You know. But yeah, mostly Java API again, lots of REST APIs, and, you know, and working with, you know, health software publishers, mostly for doctors, but not only. So that's what I did for.
I mean, you're not even 30 yet. You're not even 30 yet. And you jumped into this sort of like dev management role where, I mean, I imagine you thought you're going to be able to do a lot of architecture, design, and some mentoring, right? But people problems are the worst problems in the world, right? You didn't get to do any tech while you were in that job, or at least not that much, right?
I mean, not that much. And I think I was not ready. The only reason I got accepted because they knew me, right? I was doing a good job as a developer there. So that probably helped me because indeed I was a bit too young for this role. And I had really had no clue about proper management. I learned that a bit later. And there was also a legitimacy problem because one of the other teammates also applied for that role and got rejected. And we mostly had the same experience. And then you start, you know, as a lead with someone that wanted your position and don't think you're legitimate. So combine that with my lack of management skills at the time. And, you know, that was really created a big divide in the team. And that was really, really tough to manage for me because I didn't have enough experience and didn't even know what good management looked like. So I didn't have any example in my own from my own years of working that I could use. So it was tough.
It is, I think, almost impossible to suddenly manage a peer, someone who was a peer, like, and suddenly you're now the manager, unless they 100% buy into it and they're patting you on the back for it. It's an impossible situation. Yeah, it's just, the other thing too is, look, and I think I've said this before, the first time I had to manage somebody, they wanted to quit in a week. Like, there's no, you're not born with that. It's, you gotta have people above you who appreciate the mistakes you're gonna make in your first year trying to manage anyone and kind of coach and mentor you through it. Because I had the same sort of experience the first time. Like, somebody literally who had been there a long time was like, I can't do this anymore, I'm quitting. Like, that was an eye-opening, right? I was a tyrant. Why didn't you get this micromanaging level? Like, I'm not like that anymore. You have to learn. But at 28, I think you're right. I mean, you think you're ready, but you, all right. So how long are you in this role that you took here in 2015?
So not too long, actually. So this role and the next role I stayed for maybe 1 year and a half, so not that long. Yeah, and so mostly because I wanted to move on and I didn't really understand what the lead developer role meant. For me, it was like I had to know what everyone was doing, and I had to watch everything going. Of course, I got overstressed and burnt out, plus, you know, some legitimacy issue to solve that was really about cocktail of circumstances. And I wanted to... Actually, I could have stayed longer, right? My own manager was very supportive, and he knew, right, that I was a bit junior. He knew it, but... Then I wanted to move to big tech, so I tried Google at the time.
What time did you
almost succeed?
You tried to interview for Google, or did you get into Google?
What year is that? So I tried to get into. So it was in 2015 or 16. I'm not completely sure. Around that time, and it almost worked out. I went to the last stage, like on site. You know, did the 4 or 5 interviews. My brain was completely grilled at the end. And yeah, so somehow, unfortunately, it didn't work out. But then I went to a big tech company, I mean, labeled as that in France, so it's probably not known outside of France, which was called Criteo, which is like an ad retargeting company. But the way it was, they were attracting really top talent in Paris. And I was like, you know what, I want to see what a big company is like, and Criteo seemed like an interesting place to work at. And that's how I got in. Same interview process with more feedback. So that's actually nice. You know why you failed, contrary to what Google was doing at the time. And yeah, I stayed there a little bit, but then I realized working in a big company is also has its own set of challenges as well. So So, and the team I was at was, you know, we are doing interesting work on quite legacy software on the ad retargeting stack. But the team, so the people were, that was the first time it happened to me, actually. The team was very smart. Like, everyone was super smart and could solve super hard problem on the whiteboard, discuss, you know, live, etc. But when it came to good team practices, you know, like pair programming or, you know, or even testing, you know, I thought at that point in my career, I thought testing would not be a big debate. Like, you know, unit testing, we should try to unit test, we should try to have integration tests, et cetera, et cetera. And that was quite of a debate. And I was a bit set back by this, like, why? Well, I have these very smart people strongly objecting to some of the practices I took for granted. And given it was, you know, hard to resolve it. So I tried, you know, I tried to push. I did some small workshops, for instance, but what I read, say, taking some real code, say, hey, here is how we could refactor that together and see how much nicer it is now, how more usable it is now. But that was quite frustrating for me at that point, you know, having this discrepancy between the role skills versus the team skills. I'm not sure how to phrase this, but that was quite disparaging, quite demotivating for me.
What were their big complaints about the testing? Was it time? Like, we don't have time to write tests. We got to get product. I'm assuming this is a Java. Is this a Java role too?
So not anymore. That was my first experience. I mean, if we all meet the first one outside of Java, it was in .NET, and I knew nothing about .NET. Also, so that was quite interesting, right? At least I learned something new.
How did you get hired for? I'm assuming it was C sharp, right? How did you get hired for a C sharp job with no? I mean, you hadn't really been working on Microsoft OSs at the time. You have Java from an OOP perspective. Why did you even want it? Now I'm curious. So you have no experience. You got hired here. You had to start over. Like, were you? Yeah, I just what was going on in your head?
So the company itself would not label themselves as a C-sharp shop, and actually they had different technological stacks depending on the team. So it was large enough. They had many teams, and the process for them was: we hire generalists, and then we along you know within the process at some point we talk about possible candidate teams that the interviewee could go to. And that's really towards the end that I learned about which kind of teams they were thinking for me. And yes, they were targeting generalists at the time. So because they had some parts, you know, more, you know, more closer to the infrastructure, or some other parts heavy on data processing and machine learning, for instance, you would have Scala, etc. On that part, you would have lots of Chef for the infrastructure. And lots of C-sharp for the applications that would run on the edge of the platform. And when I went through the end of the process, I was like, okay, that's actually the teamwork seems interesting. I told them, you know, I have no experience in C-sharp. That's okay. You will learn on the job. You will get help. And that's how I signed for it, basically. And there was a factor, again, that it was a French Google, in a way. So that was also what drew me to it at the time. Like, I wanted to try this kind of company as well. So it would look good on my CV, and yeah, it would be a good experience. So that's why I...
It sounds like this was a CV move. And even if it didn't work out after a year, it wasn't going to matter, right? And then you had C-sharp on your resume. I'm kind of getting that sense.
Yeah, I mean, C-sharp was probably the side effect, but having the company name in France was quite... because people in Paris at least knew how long the process was, and it was not obvious to get in. So that served that purpose for sure. And C-sharp, it was nice to know, at least I had some experience. And that was a good, actually, not even C-sharp itself, but stepping out of the Java world a little bit, you know, and trying something new. So the process of trying something new was actually something that that helped me a lot for the companies that went after that even.
So you joined this company in 2015. How long are you there?
So I think it's 2016, maybe. I'm not completely sure on the dates. I didn't stay that long because, again, of the, you know, the team practice issues that was that were really bugging me, because it was affecting me on a daily life. Like, it was very concrete, right? People were skilled, but I felt like, you know, I was working on my own, struggling with a stack that I didn't know. People were not super available. There were not much collaboration going on in that team. And I was, okay, I want to move on.
I'm getting a sense that they were really book smart, like theory-wise, they really understood. But when it came to actually taking the hammer out, they were, that was frustrating you, because you were kind of the opposite. You had a lot of experience getting your hands dirty, building stuff. I'm kind of getting that sense from you. And you wanted to do more on the engineering side, practical.
Yeah, exactly. I'm more on the team side. I enjoy more working with people, not on my own. And that was also frustrating. And if you add that, you know, the promotion system, which was very based on individuals, like I knew some instances where people would focus very much on their own promotion and disregarding any consequences for the team or the objectives we had, you know, as long as you can get promoted, it didn't really matter. And that was a bit, you know, a bit strange to me. So I played the game a little bit, of course, because, well, if you don't get promoted for some time, then you're at risk. So I played the game, but I was like, I was working in a code base that had so many strange patterns because of that, because people would just optimize their own, you know, career path and just move to another team for another rank, and they would call it a day. And I was like, but that's not great, right? We're just sacrificing the projects we work on for that. So
yeah, the incentives were off, at least from where you wanted to be. They were off. They were about individual contribution. Not necessarily, yeah, I get it. So you're there for like, say, a couple of years. So now 2017 is kind of rolling around. What are you thinking now?
So when I was still there, a friend of mine, so the lead developer from my first job, reached out to me. He was working at Pivotal at the time. He started as a Cloud Foundry advocate and then moved on to Spring Engineering. And told me, you know what, so Pivotal, Hopper has opened office or is about to open offices in Paris. Like, would you be interested? So it was a consultancy part of Pivotal. So I was a bit hesitant. Like, do I really want to go back to consultancy? But at the same time, you know, oh, it's Pivotal, you know, it's back to Spring and, you know, people I admire, etc. So I struggled a bit with the decision, but then, you know what, I'm just going to apply. And it worked out. And so I started at Pivotal Labs. And the idea here, at least it was still consulting, but customers would come to our office, right? It would not be the contrary. So they would come, we would do, you know, like very XP, so lots of pair programming, design as well. So pairing with designers, product managers, co-located, very short iterations, very agile. So that was, and, you know, technologies I would know nothing about at the beginning of the project as well. So it was so collaborative and so productive. So that was my best team experience by far. That it was such a contrast with what I had experienced earlier. So that was actually great. And I stepped my foot into the Pivotal company as well. So I was really happy with the move I did back then.
You got everything you wanted. You got to be the coach and the mentor without managing people. You got to work on tech that you were still excited about, right? Java, Spring. You got to work on different projects. You got to stay in the office. This was like Disneyland for you here, man. This is everything you wanted. Pivotal Labs 2017. So what happens, man? It's how long are you there for?
So for the labs part, it was great, but it was intense. Like, I mean, when we say to people, you know, we work 9 to 6, they say, yeah, sure. Like everybody else, right? Sure. But like, it's intense 9 to 6, like full pairing, lots of discussion, lots of, you know, prototyping. It's really, really draining. And I was, you know, I still had this background idea of working with my, you know, with my former colleague again, because at that time he was in R&D, and they were working on this function as a service project called Reef, Project Reef, which is still online, but probably not maintained anymore. And I was like, you know what, I want to work with you again. So could that happen? It took a little bit, of course, to negotiate, you know, moving from labs to the R&D, because it was a lateral move, which was not happening often at that point. And that's how, but it worked out, and I was lucky again. And then I moved to a completely new world again, like, you know, full Kubernetes, Golang that I didn't know back then. So my colleague introduced me to it. So completely different technological landscape at the time for me, surrounded by people much more senior than me by at least 5 to 10 years at the very least. So a completely different world again, but super interesting. So many things I learned, but I've really felt like a baby that was thrown to the swimming pool, swimming with a team of Olympic swimmers or something. That's really my first 3 or 4 months were really, really like that.
I want to ask you about that, because when I have to learn something completely new, I go through a bit of a depression first, right? It's like, man, I spent all this time, I'm really good at this, and I gotta like start over. This is depressing. I know if I put a year into it, I'm gonna be happy. But I mean, that's, for me, it's a hard thing to do, to just jump into something completely brand new. I fight the fear, but I gotta, you've been doing that a lot. Like, and now again, it's completely new again. It's Kubernetes you've never seen. A new programming language, which isn't like Java or C# or PHP, completely different mindset again. Does that get you excited when you get to kind of jump in that pool for the first time? Or are you a little bit more like me? You're just like, this is a drag, man. I know only because I know how much work there is in front of me to get to where I want to be. I think that's what kind of depresses me. I just know the amount of work I have to put into it. Kind of, how do you, where does your head when you walk into these situations?
So I initially was exactly like you described. Like, I would really wanted to focus, you know, on Java, become an expert in it, and you know, really, really try hard at that. And I would really be afraid of trying, maybe not afraid, but yeah, I had this reluctance of, you know, getting my knowledge aside and start something new. And then, you know, my first experience at Criteo and learning C# kind of helped me a little bit. So it was mostly accidental, really, because I just heard what the team was doing. Then, yeah, sure, it sounds interesting. Let's learn C# on the way. But then Pivotal Labs really was a cure for me, because we would have these short projects, 3 months. We would start sometimes not knowing the stack at all. And just by pairing together, learning together, we would move so fast that it's actually, that's really helped build my confidence. Like, okay, actually I can learn something new, even with a tight deadline, so to say, that can work. So that really helped me get past the fear. And so maybe I cannot claim I'm an expert on everything that I do, but I know to learn just enough to get the thing going. And that really moved me to the opposite feeling. Like, when I can learn something new, it happened to me recently at work again. Like, I had to do something in C and C++. So I had not touched C at all since I left school. C++ never did. And actually was excited, right? Because I had like a real good excuse to learn that. That was a work task. And so it gets me excited nowadays if I can learn something new. Because I think Pivotal Labs really helped me with that, because I built confidence that I can learn and I can learn and be kind of productive doing so.
Nice. So you take this job in R&D work. So they're building out their own basically fast system out there, functions as a service. That's what Pivotal R&D is doing for their platform at the time. So you jump onto that project and you're going to start doing some like pretty heavy duty core Go kind of development in that space. What's one of the first kind of things they ask you to start working on when you join the team?
So when I joined, the first thing they asked me to work on was on the CLI, because we had this small Reef CLI, you know, to interact with the cluster, and which was probably the most gentle introduction to Go at that point. So that was actually kind of nice, because they were self-contained tasks and, you know, fast feedback, quite easy to grasp. So I really enjoyed those this onboarding really of working on the CLI. That was super easy, and I was well accompanied by my colleague as well. So yeah.
Yeah, I think that was a great kind of first jump into Go and being productive. And the CLI is, it's a front end tool, right? So you're doing front end again on the back end.
Yeah, exactly.
that's wild.
Yeah.
So how long are you at? You joined them in 2017, right? Pivotal.
Or 2018, I think.
18.
I'm sorry if my years are
no,
off.
No, it's okay. It's we can be close. How long are you there?
So I stayed there till 2020. So I work on the CLI indeed. We were trying to work on something that would make streaming like a first class citizen. So not only you would have regular functions, but you would have streaming functions. And I was working on the invoker for that. So that took me a few months with my colleague to work on that. And then what happened, I got contacted at the end of 2019 by Neo4j, which, you know, of course, I had always a special place in my heart. So I was, yeah, sure, let's discuss. So they had a developer advocate role around the community drivers. So I discussed, did the interviews in early 2020, and then pandemic.
Time out. You're doing some pretty cool core work right now. Your Go skills are getting, you see that the programming language has a lot of potential at that point. You're probably also seeing job market there. You're working on some pretty low-level stuff. I don't even see how graph database is even on your radar screen unless you go into meetups. So how does a recruiter reach out to you? Is this like LinkedIn recruiter stuff? I kind of want to know whether you just kind of glossed over it too quickly for me. Like, how does that connection?
I'm so sorry. Yeah, I'm bad at telling my own story. So Neo4j, actually, since I first learned about it, I started playing with it in 2012, mostly. And I kept doing my own side projects on it for, you know, all in parallel of all we talked about, really. Like, for instance, I started in 2014 a migration tool because it's, you know, you don't have a rigid schema, but then how do you migrate, right? So that's one of the things that was not solved at the time. So that's the kind of project that got me going for a while. So I still had, you know, projects on the side. I even did trainings, right? I had a small structure to give trainings and get paid for it around Neo4j. So I think I was one of the only ones, at least in France, giving trainings outside the program of Neo4j. So I did that also in parallel for a while.
Wait. How long were you doing that before you joined Pivotal, or when you joined Pivotal? Did they know you were doing that?
Before.
So you were, in all these jobs you were at, you were really learning the tech without actually working on projects with it. You were just kind of doing your own. And then you started training in Neo4j.
Yes.
Yeah, you didn't tell me that.
Yeah. You know, I tried to follow the job path, and then, yeah, I realized, oops, there is also this Neo4j story in parallel. That's true. So, yeah, actually, I started giving trainings quite early, maybe too early. Like, if I would do it again today, I would probably not do it because it was a lot of work. But yeah, that's the way I actually got to learn the product, you know, very well, because I had to know it before training people to use it. So I had been doing that since maybe 2013 or something, maybe one or two trainings per year, right? Not something full time, because I wouldn't have the time, but still in often enough that I would need to update my material, follow what's going on with Neo4j, and from a developer perspective, at least, right? I would not give trainings on how to maintain it in production, etc., because I wouldn't have this experience, and it was hard for me to get to that experience. So it was really developer-focused training that I maintained. And we still, actually, still a friend is working with me on this. We still do maintain it to this day, but we don't give it very often. So the Neo4j interest actually was maintained all along with side projects and trainings while I was also moving companies.
All right, so you already have the relationship with this company, essentially. So in 2020, somebody pings you and says, we've just opened up this DevRel role. We think you're perfect for it. Are you interested? And you get excited. I'm wondering why it took, what would that be, 7 years for them to consider you for this role, since you'd been doing this for so long?
Yeah, that's a mystery to me. I got in touch with them a few weeks earlier, but somehow the process stopped. I mean, it was not clear what happened, really. And so at that time, when I was contacted again by someone I knew, it was, you know, in combination with a project as a service, struggling a bit to find, you know, a user base, etc. So things were a bit going into slow motion at that time as well. And I was like, you know what, Neo4j, indeed, I've been doing that for a few years. I would love to be part of the company again. But yeah, not sure why it took so long. It's still a mystery to me to this day. I don't know why.
But you really love this product, because it sounds like when this opportunity opened up, you jumped fairly quickly. You were like, yep, this is where I want to be. This is what I want to really be doing. I want to work on this tech. I think you may have answered it. I'm going to ask you again. What is it about this tech that you love so much that you... When this opportunity came across, I'm going to say it like, let me consider it this way, as someone who's a little bit ignorant. This tech isn't new. This isn't new tech, right? This thing has been built, has existed for a long time, right? One of the things I liked about dgraph was they built a brand new graph database from the ground up with like Kubernetes in mind, right? To run something in a stateless sort of distributed environment. This is proven tech, but it's kind of older tech, and you're working on a lot of new tech right now. So what is it about this product or this tech that you have such an affinity for?
Yeah, I mean, it's a great question. I'm not sure I have, it's a bit, you know, subjective as well, and maybe not completely rational as well, but I still had these memories when I first used their language, their query language, which was so expressive to me, and, you know, doing such powerful querying, traversing the graph, etc., those impressions got stuck. And then, you know, the more I was giving trainings, I used their product, and it just felt great. I had good interactions with their people. And so, you know, it was not a completely rational choice, that's for sure. But, you know, summing those, that looks like a good company. The CEO is great. I have good relationships with some of their employees that I know. And you know, and plus the fact that I was working on new tech indeed, but it was such a struggle for a long time, right? I was completely new to all this, and it was so much to digest. I'm like, yeah, what if I work at Neo4j? For once in my career, I will already know something before I start. So that would be a great change, right? So that also, maybe some kind of comfort, maybe seeking some comfort before, when I join as well. And that really also helped me. For the confidence as well when discussing, because I almost didn't need any onboarding because I knew most of the things already. So that really felt great for the first time as well. So probably why I switched, even though I was working, yeah, indeed, on exciting technologies and an exciting, you know, market segment.
But DevRel is a whole nother. I know you had the experience being in a classroom twice a year, but. What did they tell you this role was going to be? What did you expect the role to be?
So when they described me as a role, one of the first things they told me is, you don't have to go to a gazillion conferences every year. It's not what we're seeking here. We're seeking more, you know, hands-on, you know, more, you know, developer bias toward development more than, you know, pure advocacy. So that's one of the things that reassured me, because I love going to conferences from time to time, but I could not afford going, you know, every week to another country, etc., like some of my former colleagues in the advocacy did. So that and so they told me it's about, you know, we have a driver's team, but it's super busy. There are not enough people to also, you know, cater for community relationships. So we need someone really to try to fill the gaps between what the driver team is doing and what driver users and what driver maintainers out of the company need. So we need someone to help smooth those relationships and, yeah, maintain them, because it takes time. And the team at the time didn't have that time.
No, you had all the experience for this role. I mean, when you think about all the jobs you had, from the consulting to product to big company, small company, this was like you were almost raised to do this. this role, right? You got to be an engineer. You had Go experience, which I'm sure was incredibly hard to find at the time. Well, it's 2020, but somebody who wants to do this role with that Go experience. Was the Go driver one of the first things on your radar because of your Go experience? You think that helped at all with getting the position?
I think that helped indeed. So not only knowing Java, because almost everyone at Neo4j, because the core product is in Java and Scala, almost everyone knew that. But having someone knowing Go, and also, you know, I touched C#, etc. before, so that kind of helped, because we had, you know, we have these five official languages that we support. So yes, the polyglot aspect helped. And yeah, and indeed, so in retrospect, that really felt like the role was for me, and I was super grateful when I joined. And on day one, the first thing I did was resurrect some old Go examples, for instance. That's the first thing I did when I joined. So it was a great, yeah, quite happy with the move I did back then.
Yeah, I mean, you've been there for 2 years, which is kind of a milestone, right? Because you've only been at one place where you were, I think you had one place where you were 4 years, right? And I can tell.
Yeah, I moved quite a lot.
No, but I don't have a problem with that. Yeah, if you're not happy where you are and you're not, you work because you have to make money, right? Like, I don't know if you have a family or not, but at the end of the day, you have bills to pay. You gotta, right? Like, you have to work. But at the same time, if you're miserable every day at your job, there's no value in that either, right? So, you know, I really love the fact that you were there for a year, year and a half. It wasn't right. This place was pretty good, and now I can just tell you're really happy, kind of where you are right now and the work you're doing.
Yeah, absolutely. That's finally got all the ingredients I wanted, like a product I love, a solid customer base on technologies I love, and, you know, good collaborations. That's because I had some of those in all of the previous experiences, but never all together. So that was really the first time I had all of these ingredients. So that was, yeah, a change I really needed, I think. But then there's still a last change, right? Because I stayed 3 months in DevRel, and then I moved on to the driver's team itself. I kept the DevRel role, but I realized it was my first DevRel gig, but it's so hard, right? There are so many different roles and responsibilities as a DevRel that there was an opportunity that happened a bit after I joined, like the Go driver maintainer wanted to move to another team. And so I jumped to that. And now, yes, that was the last change. I promise. That's the last change.
No, that's not your last change. You're too young for that.
At least for now, yes. But yeah, no, I'm quite happy where I am, you know, in the driver's team, but still doing community work, meetings with community driver authors, etc. So yeah.
I'm curious, with such an established product, and I don't know the product very well. So, are they adding enough new features every year that require changes to the driver? I mean, backwards compatibility obviously is massive for you there. But like, is there enough dev work all the time to be improving the drivers, or is it a lot more of your time being spent helping customers with the drivers so they can build the products that they need to build?
So no, there is actually almost full time working on the driver, because there are indeed new features coming in. Sometimes, you know, very low in the stack, and that pops up to the driver, like the work we're gonna do in the next major version. But we also have one big topic. So because the company has hired so much in the recent years, we finally staffed enough to take some time and try to unify the driver behavior, which is a big topic. Like you want to be able to reason about the same things regardless of the driver you use, at least the official driver you use. And we've been working quite hard on that, making sure not only, of course, the API is consistent, so that's the easy part, so to say, but the behavior as well is consistent. And of course, because, you know, you have five different drivers, sometimes you have discrepancies that are not obvious, but also, you know, breaking expectations of customers. So there is also a big chunk of work, you know, figuring out what's different and how to reconcile it if we can and when we can.
So that scares me a little bit, right? Because I feel like every language has their idioms and their ways of doing things, and developers in those languages expect that. It goes back to, and I understand why, it's my understanding that Amazon essentially code-gens their APIs because they have to support so many different languages and platforms that the scale of having a purely individualized API that's, say, coded with the right guidelines and idioms would be overwhelming, right? So at least on the Go side, you have pointers everywhere because it's the safest way to regen an API around that, right? So, but then you lose that feel of the API that you're expecting to have as well. So there's a balance there, right? Are you thinking that we're gonna code gen at some level these drivers, so there's maybe one code base and we're able to generate this, and or like, where's your team's head on that? Because I think it's an important kind of engineering trade-off to have. Do we want the Java developer and the Go developer to have their true experience, or it's not important because we're a small team and we have to kind of cater to the larger picture?
So I think right now we're very much into trying to make sure things are idiomatic. And that's been a struggle sometimes because, you know, indeed we want consistency, but we don't want to sacrifice, idiomaticity. I'm not sure it's a word, but I'm going to say it, idiomaticity. And sometimes indeed discussions are not always easy when we discover differences, for instance, but sometimes I say, but I don't want to fix that in Go because that's the expected behavior. That's the way things work. And so sometimes we just agree on that. We don't always blindly say consistency is more important, so we should basically erase every difference. But that's really on a case-per-case basis, really. But it's a tough call. That's one of the tension we have in the team, right? Like how do we express things in C#? Or that was one of the criticisms we got early in the early days. Like C# felt like Java. The C# driver was feeling like a Java driver. And for users, it was terrible, it seems. I mean, I heard. and even the history of the Go driver is interesting because initially, the team lead at the time authored a C library that would power different drivers. And so we had a C library and a Go driver built on it with CGO. And users hated it. They said, you know what, it's too clunky to install. We don't want to deal with this. And basically that C library got killed because of that. And that's why this Go driver was born again and was rewritten from scratch because the user experience was just horrible with the C library below.
I think it's a trust issue. If you see a package that's not written in the idioms for the language you expect, I think you just don't trust the engineering behind it. Whether it's right or wrong, it's irrelevant, right? When you're evaluating anything that you're going to bring into your product, regardless of the language, you're evaluating syntax, idioms, API usage, and if you don't see those things, I think it becomes a trust issue. And if I can't trust this, how can I trust my application's going to work, right? I mean, you're doing trust engineering at the end of the day when you really think about it.
Yeah, that's exactly that. And we're also investing quite a lot in having designers help us also figure that out, like having, you know, user interviews and trying to understand where the gaps are and how we can help with that, which is, of course, challenging because designers usually, I mean, not from what I know, at least with the designer I work with, they usually liked, you know, graphical user interface better because it's easier to prototype and reason about. But We also, we're working quite hard on that at the moment. So we're still in the middle of this, but trying to figure out where the gaps are first and foremost, right? We'd rather be super idiomatic and a bit less consistent than the other way around. So that's the thing we are, working hard at.
With backwards compatibility, as you improve the next version that people can migrate to, you need the Go fix program at some point, right? To migrate to the next. It's a lot of engineering. Steve Francier, who's on the Go team now, he drove the drivers for Mongo DB at the time. And I remember talking to him about this and like how mind-blowingly complex this this is for any company, you know, that has to support all of these different communities. So yeah, always impressed. You're gonna, yeah, I'm sure you've learned a lot already in the last 2 years, and it's really great engineering experience there.
Yeah, definitely. And we were right in the middle of this because we are shipping a new major version and we're trying to draw the line, like how much do we want to break? Because we're allowed to. But, you know, there is also this balance, like let's not screw everyone upgrade. Let's try to keep it reasonable as well. So that's a fun challenge.
Yeah, I would scream. Yeah, every time OpenTelemetry, they went to, at least they've released finally 1.0, but my God, I wanted to cry and scream at people every couple of weeks when they were just, they were like, well, we have freedom to break the API. No, you don't. Stop. Like, stop doing it, please. Yeah. Like, you're driving me crazy. I'm losing a half an hour every 2 weeks trying to figure out the change. So I get the idea that I think the one thing about Go that has been brilliant, right, is they have, to a T, maintain their backwards compatibility on the language, right? You do never have to worry about waking up in the morning and the next point release or major release isn't going to compile your program, right? Just, again, trust engineering, right? We trust that. And people can complain all they want that it's not moving feature-wise fast enough, but you sleep at night.
Yeah, completely agree. And I'm also trying to keep as much as I can and maintain as much as I can, even, you know, older protocol version between the server and the client. I know some of the drivers like completely removed that from their code base because it makes things easier, but I'm like, why would I remove that support? You know, it's just going to make the life of some people more complex. So yeah, that's part of the things we've come a long way, really. I think honestly, in terms of backward compatibility, we still have rooms for improvement, but we're really trying hard to, even though, you know, we are going to come to a new major version, make sure the upgrade remains smooth and not to break, you know, make everyone life a nightmare for when the new version comes out. That's an interesting topic for sure.
Yeah, and complex. All right, we are out of time, unfortunately. I've enjoyed talking to you tremendously, and I love your background, right? I love that you ended up exactly, at least right now, where you wanted to be with the tech that you kind of fell in love with even early on in your career. So that's really kind of brilliant.
Thank you. And I really enjoyed trying to tell my story in a disorganized way.
it's perfect. All right. If anybody wants to reach out to you after listening to the show, and we'll put everything in the show notes as well, what's the best way for someone to reach out?
I think Twitter is the best way. I'm kind of addicted to it. So yeah, FBIVILLE, that's where I am.
All right, perfect. All right, Lucen, thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us. This is the Ardan Labs podcast. Florent and I signing off, and hope to see everybody again real soon.